Hey friends, how's it going? We have another great video today. I am in Denver, Colorado for PACE. Yes, I get to see amazing painters today, and they are just, oh, it's so cool. After all this time of COVID and all that business, we are now getting to meet each other in person after talking and meeting each other for the past 3 years on Zoom, and finally getting to do some fist bumps, high fives, even some awesome hugs. And one of those people is Richie. And we're gonna go to this interview right now. I'm not gonna take up too much of your time, but if you're ever thinking about doing an event like this, like PACE, the convention, plein air convention, that's what I'm talking about. That's where I am today. And there's so many more things to see, but we're going to dive into Richie's story about how he got into plein air painting. There's so many nuggets, and I think you're going to really enjoy it, and you're going to probably want to connect with him for sure after this video. All right, without any further ado, enjoy.
24/7 commitments. Like, if I'm driving, my mind is keep on painting. My mind is keep on paintings everywhere. Like, everything, like, when I see lights, how you just pose and them, it's a 24-hour job in my mind. So it's not just you paint. When you paint, is my problem actually is how to stop.
Thank you so much. We have another video for you guys about my friend here, Richie. I want you guys to know about his story. You might have been wondering what to do with watercolor. You've learned some basics about watercolor, and there's different circles and different camps of watercolor, whether it's realism, whether it's abstract. But Richie here is gonna, you know, talk about today some of his plein air experiences. We interviewed some other people that like to get out there and do, whether it was urban sketching with some watercolor. But without any further ado, you're not here to listen to me. We're here to talk to Richie. Hello, Richie. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks for inviting me, Gabriel. It's my pleasure.
For sure. And could you tell us a little bit about your life story? Were you an artist when you were a kid? Did you pick it up later? When did watercolor come into your life?
Okay, that's a long story to tell, but I'm going to shorten for sure. I'm a Filipino, born and raised back in the Pacific, so the other side of the globe. So I'm born and raised with the artist family. My father's an artist too, my brothers and everything. So five of us can paint. So technically our house smells like turpentine. Paint all the time. And as I grew up, my father didn't teach me like a very formal teaching about arts, but I grew up with it, like, you know, every Sunday. My father, by the way, is not like a full-time artist. I have other job, but at the same time doing art, you know. And I surrounded with all those watercolors and oils and everything. But for me, it's just like, no, I'm just a kid. It's just hyper kid. And soon I got I'm taking a fine arts degree. And my father told me that, oh, it's hard to, you know, to earn a living as an artist, especially we're in the, you know, the third world country. So I'm taking up a Bachelor of Science in Architecture, just like my brother. So I take up architecture. That's where I introduced formally with watercolor, and a lot of drawings, man, a lot of drawings. So that's, for me, that's my foundation. You know, when you go to old school, I mean, architecture academics, so 2 years, all the geometric forms, the lines, all the basic things, it have to be, you know, almost memorized, like automatic, all the drawings and everything. I'm talking about the old school. I don't know. Today, if they're teaching the drawing, so that's where my background, all the drawings. And I got married, and I got, after I graduate, get my degree, I got my license. So I teach presentations, more of the drawing. So that's where the serious business come in with the watercolors and drawings. Like, oh, I can earn a living. Yeah, the thing that I love most. So I practiced as an architect for 7 years. And then luckily, my ex-wife got an offer to work in the US. Like, dang. I mean, we love the other side. Like, oh, we have the chance to go to America. So in 2005, I guess. Yeah, everything's like stop everything. We migrate in Florida. So I work as an architectural designer in Florida, but I never touch pencil at all because, you know, all done with computer. So all done with the computer, all the rivets and all the SketchUp programs. I got lost, man. I got lost. Like somebody like cut my hands, cut my feet. I feel lost for 7 years living in the cubicles. Because all those computers and everything. So like, man, I'm totally other person. You know? So I decided to back home to practice again after 7 years. So within the span of 5 years, my family is here and back in the Philippines. So every year I flew back here to visit my kids, you know, and, you know, visit US. So expensive. So it's I earning peso and spending dollars. It's not a smart move. But by doing so, I have my firm working again. I teach in university. So on the weekend, I have all the time because my family is here. So that's where I started to pick a watercolor again. I start with, you know, the urban sketching type, you know, have some friends invited. So we, you know, drawings and everything. And after that, we have some food, drinking maybe somehow, sometimes on Fridays. And pick up watercolor. We're going to get from 11 by 17, from 9 to 10, and then getting bigger, getting more confidence. And then, like I said, I went to US every year, especially on Christmas, to visit my kids for 3 months. So that's a time we live in Baltimore. So that's why I go to the mall, which is the, you know, so awesome in DC. So check up the museums and everything, and start doing watercolors. And I decided myself, I think this is my calling. I feel happy. I feel grounded. There's something here. I mean, sometimes it's not about money, you know. It's like, maybe, I don't know. I mean, but it's hard to earn a living. I mean, I think you have to take the call of, you know, hard life as an artist. But then I discovered plein air. First, I discovered, I think, Alvaro Castanet. Like, wow, this guy, I love the style, and he's like, do the, you know, as an artist, I mean, you know, as a living, like, wow. And then at the same time, you can travel and everything. So after 5 years, keep on visiting, to I paint on the street on my vacation, and then somebody told me like, hey, you have some chops there. So, and then back then we already moved from Baltimore, because at first we lived in Florida. Like I said, it's almost, weather-wise, it's almost the same in the Philippines. So like, can we go like colder countries so that like you feel like, you know, cold? You can wear your turtleneck whatsoever. And then it's so cold. So we transferred in Texas. And after that, like I said, I went on the street. I didn't know that's the plein air. I just paint to enjoy myself, and somebody, like I said, interested in my work. Like, oh, how much is your work? I mean, you know, I'm interested. Like, oh, I don't know. I don't have a price yet. I have no clue. So, but she invited me to go to the local, local league, in Victoria Art League in Texas, to be a member. And then from there on, I have the idea, like, maybe I can earn a living for this. So now after that, instead of just circling the lake, I'm planning to swim. So back in the Philippines and unplug everything. So like boy, I don't know what I'm thinking there. It's crazy. But like, if this one doesn't work, at least I'm closer to my kids. I already won. In my mind, I already won. Even though it's not like I work from the scratch. So I start from architect, no job, no cars, no. I'm back from scratch again after 7 years. So, but again, I apply in Art League as a resident artist. But I pray to God that God give me sign that I'm going to do this. I mean, you know, big sign, like say yes or no, whatever. And my residency is approved. And then I have 1 year of free lodging, free studio, and I have time to teach. Like, I think this is it. So I unplug my firm and everything. And from there, I start. No cars. And then I work with what I think I work in the golf course, because sometimes I play golf. Like, oh, okay, I work here with no cars. I had my last money, it's probably $200. I bought a bike just to go from point A to B. At least I have my job in the golf course every like 2 days, and then teach and paint teach. But the priority, the big goal, is to be an artist. So I work in the golf course, but I was cart, but my mind is keep on painting. Like, this is just a stage. This is just, you know, temporary. At the same time, I teach. So from there on, I have the idea. So because you have the Gibbon already, members. So I teach there every other day, and then I earn some money, and then from there, like, wow, I feel like an artist. I feel alive.
That's so good. That's so good. Like, I love hearing this story, because, you know, so many people are wondering, you know, they have come from families that are artists, but they didn't know, you know, they made some choices, maybe had some kids. I think this is great hearing your story. I too am a divorcee, you know, but I have a good relationship with the mother to keep in contact with my kids. And we're hearing this beautiful story of, you know, this hunger. And I love how you start with your story of drawing really well. And we can see this in your work. And the other thing I'm hearing that's really good is to have a good mentor, someone that's already doing what you would like to be doing, like Alvaro, you know, or Joseph, you know, people that are doing. So you don't necessarily have to like reinvent the wheel, but to be around like-minded people that are successful, because you see yourself being there. It's just a matter of time. And I like hearing, I mean, I remember too, taking a bus, getting on a bicycle, and even a train to go teach over at Hobby Lobby. And I brought my 11-year-old with me, you know, and she's like,
oh my gosh, this bus is late, Dad, you know? And I'm like, we're going to make it there. We're going to do really good, you know? And so I love hearing your story. Could you just emphasize a little bit before we get into the technical and parts of supplies and whatnot? Could you just talk about, emphasize on importance of having a mentor?
Yes, that's very big to me. First, it's like doing the GPS. You plug what you're going to point B and then enjoy the ride in between. But at least you know where you're going. So like in my case, I accept that I'm a product of Alvaro and Joseph. No, I admire all other artists like, you know, Thomas Schaller, because he's so free with his style. I admire you, your style. Everybody's different, so there's no need to debate. But again, Alvaro and Joseph, a little bit of Alvaro, a little bit of Joseph, and a lot of me. Yeah. So the important is you know what you like to be as an artist. Especially in my workshop, I always say, like, you know, you have to know, like, are you like this style or you want to break new rules in your case, like, you know, the other side of your skill. Sometimes it works, sometimes does it work, but the important is you know where you're going and you love the medium.
I agree. And if people really look at your painting, you are like hungry to find the next thing to paint. I see this in your posting. When you're posting your painting, you're really looking for the next thing to paint. And can you talk about that? How do you find your subject matter? And I know one of the answers is getting out of the house.
Absolutely, sir. So me, I juggle my schedule between sports and paintings or arts in general, because, you know, if your body is healthy, you produce a healthy product too. So I, especially on my off season from November to February, I do a lot of exercise, because once the plein air kick in, man, it's hard. It's hard to have time. But anyway, back to your questions. So like I said, to find subject, I think it's a 24/7 commitment. Like if I'm driving, my mind is keep on painting. My mind is keep on paintings everywhere, like everything, like when I see lights, how you juxtapose them. It's a 24-hour job in my mind. So it's not just you paint when you paint. It's my problem actually is how to stop. So I have question, like either take a night quill or take the bourbon. So sometimes I take night quill, sometimes I take bourbon.
So it sounds like you're painting when you're not even have a paintbrush in your hand.
Yes. I mean, the mind is keep on painting. The problem is that I have 2 major accidents in 2 years, 4 years. Like I almost died because like when I drive, like, oh, that's a good one. Boom. Oh, that's a good one. So I promised myself, did painter cannot paint. I just like, that's a good one. That's the negative side. It's hard when I paint, it's hard for me to drive. It's hard for me to do something because it takes time to get rid of the juice in my mind.
That's so good. And I'm sure there are people watching this, like the Dreamliners. They're part of, you know, the Plein Air magazine following. You're in the magazines. You're also in the competitions. You have your own video. Can you just tell us, how did you get started in competitions? Because I'm sure people are, you know, considering if their work might be ready or not for competition.
That's a good question. Thanks for question that. So first, in 2019, I moved here in the US 2017 late, and then 2018, that's where I pick up the things. 2019, I start competing And then like, I need something here because I need to live. I mean, you know, if you back against the wall, no other way, just back down. If you're like sink or swim lifestyle, so I have to do something here. My income is not that great. I have to accelerate. So I found out Clean Air Magazine, their full color event in Santa Fe 2019. Like, oh boy, it's expensive. So I have to, like, you know, I have to save a lot to go there in Santa Fe for my first time. But I have reason in my mind, so it have to be a return of investment. So I have to meet Eric. I have to meet Eric. So when we go there in Santa Fe, and then Eric told me, like, hey, who wants to do free demo, you know? And I did. This is my opportunity. So I raised my hand, like, hey, I'm willing to do demo. And Eric said, and who are you? Richie Vios, like, okay, that's the name. So everybody's watching me. Who's this crazy guy? So, like I said, I mean, I think life have to be 90% or 10% what's going on surrounded you, but 90% how you react. How you react. So, I mean, if there's no door opening, make a new door. Make a new door. So that's my principle back then. I mean, like I said, sink or swim. So when I meet Eric, so like, I do the demos and everything. So from there on, I think maybe Eric have, you know, planted the my name in his brain. And then the following day, I think that God guide me. And the following day, Eric Rhodes' car, from rental car, is not yet arrived. And then my roommate is a friend of Eric, and then Eric need a ride, I offer myself. And then from there, Eric ride to like a day going for my paid out. And then, you know, when you're side by side with Eric, you took a lot. And then we paint, and then when I paint, I make sure that Eric knows me. So I went like side by side with Eric, took picture with Eric, you know, you have to. And then Eric noticed my works. Then yeah, you know, you have to perform every painting that's your best painting. So like in the afternoon or late evening, we have programs and everything. So I try to market myself, talk with people, talk with somebody, help, because I know this will be have a good return. So not just, you know, it's a God-given talent, I believe, so I have to share it. So it's not my own. So it is my calling, so I have to share. So I have some friends. Until now, we're friends. I mean, all those ladies or men that I encountered for my first event, I mean, I call it event in full color, we're still friends. So that's, for me, that's how important, like, you know, you make your, like, you know, make a door. If no door opening, make a door.
I agree. It sounds like what I'm hearing is there's a lot of entrepreneur in you. It helps to be hungry and to open a door then instead of sitting there on your laurels and waiting for someone to invite you. And way to go. You know, some people are watching this. We're having a good time. We're talking. It's almost a celebration, right? To be where you are today. But people want to know, do you make bad paintings?
Bad paintings is it's synonymous with a good painting. So there's a lot. But again, in bad painting, there's at least one there that's good. You can carry that over that one to the next painting. So it's not bad at all. You learn something. Like, why it's become like this? It's muddy and everything. Oh, that's why. And then you can carry over for the next painting.
And we do. We learn more from our mistakes than our wins sometimes, you know? And some people, they ask this question, you know, to artists, and they say, how long did it take you to paint that? And I know you're a fast painter. And what is your answer to that when someone says, how long did it take you to paint that?
Yeah, it's a simple question. I said, just 3 hours and 20 years. Yeah, and so
And I think what you mean by that is you've done many paintings, right? And it took all those paintings to get to this one painting. And I see that in your work. I see nice consistency. And even though you're very humble and giving tribute to your mentors, I see you painting things that they don't paint. You really put yourself out there. You make these beautiful sunset paintings. You also tackle some structures that shows your knowledge of how things work and move. Your structures, I like you spend a lot of time on perspective. When someone asks me, like, who can I learn perspective from? I go, well, you can either get a book on perspective, or you can go get Richie's video with Streamline, because I know he makes sure that those vanishing points work. And what is one thing someone could learn from your video?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot, especially the backbones of a good painting. So of course you have the values, the colors, the values, the colors, the edges, and what it had to be for. I forgot. But again, for my video is more on like the perspective, of course. Like I said, it's the backbones, the drawings. So if the just like a human figure is the backbone, if the bone is not good, it's crooked, everything's crooked. So you cannot fix that one. So even though you put makeups or whatever, still there's something wrong when you walk. So the backbone, that's important, especially in watercolor. Especially when you draw like a cityscape, I mean, all the vanishing points and everything, plus the aerial perspective, you know. So there's a lot to consider, but that's the technical side. I mean, some workshop that you can learn that one in overnight, like, you know, the perspectives, the values and edges, but the execution, it takes longer time, depending on the how time you allotted. So, of course, the longer the mileage, the bigger the mileage, the better you are. So, I mean, especially watercolor, a big thing you have to draw. You're at least, I mean, decent in drawings, because it's once you get a mistake, you miss the highlights. Game over. Game over.
So good.
That's so good.
What would you, you've been, you know, you're not an overnight success. You've been painting for quite some time. What have you seen? What changes have you seen in the watercolor industry?
Oh, thanks for bringing up that question, Gabriel. When I first compete in the event, I mean, out of maybe 90 or 45, is depending the event, maybe only two of that in watercolor. And then it's just in the corner, you know. And then when I, like, you know, compete and everything, sometimes people say, wow, this guy can compete with oil. So especially in terms of how I present, I present like an oil. Sometimes, I don't know if the one is disadvantage. Sometimes you can hardly tell the difference color-wise because I try to push watercolor. Push watercolor, like sometimes you can see like there's some watercolor, it's so pale, like, oh, I don't want a watercolor, but it's, the color is so pale. That's a challenge, number one. Like how become like intense. So I look for a product that's so intense. I look how the watercolor consistency, like very strong, the type of brush, the angle, the temperature, like, okay. So those are the challenges in between that you have to answer. But again, I mean, I cannot trade watercolor for the different medium. I'm gonna live with watercolor and then I die a watercolor artist.
Yeah, I agree. You know, I show with oil painters too, like La Papa in Laguna Beach. And one lady was like, I want to buy this painting. This oil painting's beautiful. And the lady's like, oh, wait, this is a watercolor. And she's like, what? And they're like, yeah, you can't get the transparency that he has, but he has those thick things of paint that feel like oil painting. And some people that are out there, some of my students have asked this question, is how can you paint a picture so it doesn't just look like any other Joe Schmo could just paint this too? Like, how do you get a painting to stand out in a show that's like a competition?
Oh, yeah. I mean, when I compete, I study the history of the town. That's one, the iconic, that's one. And when I compete, I have divide my, like, for example, for 3 days, 4 days, we produce 7 to 8 paintings. So I divide that one into 3. So other part will be, this will be like very simple one, like, you know, just to sell. Like very simple compositions, very iconic. Yeah, that's one part. And then the other part to be like highly well-thought composition, that's for the judge. And the size is big, the price is big, the frame is big, color wise. So I have to like, you know, the classic, the very academic, because that's where the judge is looking from, like, you know. And the third part will be something new that excites me. So something new. So if I see that thing, I push like crazy abstract color, abstract composition. From night, I'm gonna paint today or vice versa. From sunny, I make it into a rainy. It's just what's inside my mind. And then it works. I mean, it stands out because it's different. For me, the key to be successful is you have to be different. I think the scale wise and everything is just, I mean, you know, you earn a living for skills and everything, but if you want to be, you know, next level, I mean, you have to be unique. I mean, if you see some of those, you know, very successful artists, they have something unique qualities on it, something unique qualities on it that's different. Whether you're a singer, whether you're a writer, whether you're a visual artist or whatever, if you want to succeed, be unique. So be unique.
And I know there's some people probably watching that are probably wondering, okay, I'd like to try this competition plein air painting thing. I also probably, like, they're thinking, I like researching old buildings, these unique cities. I would like to visit and travel them and go do a competition. But how do you frame your art for the competition?
Technically frame, you said? Yes, I frame. Don't get me wrong, I still have the classic way with all the mat and the glass. But when you're on the road, it's so difficult. You know, you bring your matting with you and then you mat and then just dust particle. Like, oh, I have to reframe again. So Hell no. Like, and then you cannot, when I on the road, normally I make some loop. So it's like a 3 events in one big loop, one ride. So it's like 1 month to 1 month and a half. So I'm bringing maybe 30 paintings with me, frames and everything. So if you bring glass, that's not practical at all. So right now I'm spraying with Krylon. Technically, it's like a liquid glass. I mean, people before, they don't have, you know, confidence with the spray. But technology now is catching up. So this will be a liquid glass and archival, non-yellowing. So it's much better than glass. So I just spray, and then I have glass. And pop in the plein air frame, which is the same from oil painters. And then, voila.
Yeah, you don't have to worry about dust bunnies getting in there in the back of the pickup. Or I had to do one time frame it on a picnic table. And, you know, the seagulls are flying over me. I'm like, no, don't you even dare, you know. And these things that we do, but they're discoveries, they're adventures, you know. As a divorcee, I needed some new experiences to let some of the bad memories go. And the only way that happened was to get out there and paint for me, per se. And I developed some good experiences. I met some good friends along the way. And how important is it to have good groups? I know you have this one group that's called the Rattlesnake Gang. Can you talk about these guys?
Yes. Probably 70% of the Rattlesnake Gang is retired architect. So, and then you can tell that we love colors, watercolors in general, because that's how we train. That's how we present back in the days. You know? So there's no computer yet, but I can do a computer, so I'm half-baked. So I can do like digital from Procreate to pen and everything, but there's no soul in it. So still I love those T-squares and classic. But back to your question, yes. I met those guys in San Angelo, and they invited me. I think they're doing the already fourth year. They're going to one event. So normally the plenary event kick in on March in the South, which is the other state of the country. It's super cold. So in South, it's doable. It's not super cold anymore. So March. So in Feb, they try to like group together just to, you know, sharpen the tools per se. So they go in Big Bend for now. It's 8 years. So next week we're going again. I think it's our 8 years, but for me, it's my third year. Yeah. So they invited me to paint, and man, boy, it's, I cannot trade for that painting for a week in National Park. And with your friends and without computations and, you know, without, just enjoy the ride. It's, and then we eat after that. Really cool.
And I heard something about cowboy coffee or something recently.
Yeah. Yes, sir. The fire. And I have some friends from born and raised in Texas. I mean, boy, I mean, I see like, wow, it's a real cowboy. Like, you know, you can see in the morning, they have their what's called the one, their boots. I'm like, wow, the first time. Takes time. It's really cool. And Big Bend, if you have the chance, visit Texas, visit Big Bend National Park. It's so huge. I mean, you know, almost probably a day drive. Just to from other side, big. Everything is big in Texas.
So good. So what states do you typically paint in when you're traveling? And are there some states that you would like to go paint in?
Yes, I'm looking forward because the La Papa invited me actually last year, but my schedule is already booked the time. So this year I'm looking forward to go to La Papa and paint those coastal scene, which is remind me home. It's almost look like the Philippines. So I'm looking forward to that, because last year or the other year I went to San Francisco. Boy, it's so foggy and cold. I'm not ready for that. It's summer, but it's super cold. National Park, that's my goal. And of course, the Grand Canyon. So I want to emerge for a week and just paint. So yeah, that's my in the future. So.
And let's talk a little bit about paint. What do you like to use for paint?
I start before for 3 years. Daniel Smith. So I use Daniel Smith all the time. And lately I explore some different, you know, because like, for example, in one color only, different medium or different brand have a different reaction, different color. So when I teach, I didn't say the specific name, like ultramarine blue. You know, I said my blue, this is my blue, but I cannot say like this, because if they follow this color and then they have a different brand, have a different reaction. Yeah. But my palette is simple. Like almost colors, I have warm and cool. But when I see blue, I use ultramarine blue. And I start with the triad, of course, the foundation. So everything I do start with basic. Everything I do, like color, I have my ultramarine blue. For my blue, I have a little crimson. For my red and yellow ochre. So that's my triad. So I just push and pull, just like L.A. Lakers, the triangle offense. So I mix that one. And then when it looks like I want to be a red side, I pump a lot of crimson, mix again with the triad. And it looks like I need more cool colors, I pump with ultramarine blue. But I know that will turns grayish blue, grayish red, grayish yellow. So I'm start with that. And then after I, you know, see all the values and everything, so that's I pump with colors, sometimes straight from the tube. So I start with almost like oil, watercolor, so loose, so watery. And then I end up butter, just like painting oil paint. So that's how I define my palette. So
could you tell us the importance of paper and what you like to use?
Before I use Arches all the time, a little bit of Fabriano for 3 years, 4 years, and my friends introduced me with Saunders. Can I mention brand, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so try this, Richie. So Saunders, lately, I love Saunders, you know, because it's so delicate. So the sizing is not that much. So that's why the color, you know, it's so intense. But the downside, you have to be, you know, you have to be very particular, be keen on how many strokes you have, because it's easy to overdo, because it's easy to make, like, it's almost like painting tissue paper. It will absorb everything. No, so you have to be precise, make every stroke count. So the lesser the stroke, the better you are. So before Arches, because of the sizing, you can play around. You can karate your paper. So I'm using 140 pounds Saunders Waterford lately. For
cold press.
Cold press, yes, sir. Yeah. But I use a hot press when I do some like a portrait, because it's easy to lift the color, because so there's no valley and hills. Yeah. So like I said, who's introducing me to try Saunders is my friend. So you can tell that your people surrounded you, it's important. because you can see, oh, I'm going to try this one, try this, Richie. Oh, yeah. So you need group as an artist. We need group. Although we need isolation too, but we need group. So that's why I have some studio, which is I'm allowed to be alone. Nobody can bother me. I love to compete. So that I have my friends. So I become normal.
How are your studio paintings different than your plein air paintings?
My studio painting is somehow I try to mimic my how I execute my work. So sometimes you can't really tell the difference between the plein air and studio. That's my quest. So me, it's different. Some people go plein air to have study. Me, it's different. I paint on the studio to have the study, to have the skills. And I apply that one on plein air in past mood. Like sometimes I don't think anymore. The repetition. So I do that in the studio, repeat, learn the new things, do it again. And then when I do outside, I don't think anymore. It's just like squeezing a sponge, like.
Very nice. And people are probably wondering, what brushes do you like to use?
Yes, of course. Ta-da! I think everybody used this one. The Z. So I start. I'm a big fan with Z. This guy, like I mentioned ago. So yeah, but I'm gonna treat Alvaro this coming this coming convention in Denver, because that's the first time I will see Alvaro. So again, I use Skoda all the time. I mean, I start with the Skoda signature Alvaro Castané signature series. And lately, like sometimes I feel like I'm going to be Z today. So I use Z. So I mix these two. So it's all Skoda. For me, that's the ultimate brush for watercolor.
And that's the only brush you use?
Brand-wise? Yeah, I use sometimes Chinese brass a lot. I use Perla. So I use a lot. I mean, sometimes I buy, you know, those ugly brass, cheap brass to make like, you know, I'm sometimes I karate that one, you know, like, so yeah. But for like big brass, the delicate, like for example, like the initial was, from T watercolor consistency to middle values, I use squirrel brush, the expensive one. Yeah, because I mean, you know, that's the biggie. That's what makes your watercolor glow. You know, the color have to be afloat with the paper. Yeah. It have to be. You know. And then after that, when you have the mid-tone or the middle tone, from milky to butter, you can buy the less expensive, and then you can karate the one. But that's not so this good. One.
Right, for sure. I totally agree. What do you hope that people will take from viewing your art?
First, I have to say to them that enjoy the moment. Yeah, because if you're not having fun, trust me, you will not last long. So enjoy your work, enjoy while you're painting, and be confident. But it's hard. It's easy to say be confident, but before you get confidence, you have to learn the skills. So learn the skills, and at the same time, simultaneously, your confidence will be raised up too. And once that one will be leveled, you're having fun. And do not compare. You is you. Put you in your paintings. Do not compare. Like I said, as an artist, we're designed to be unique, not to blend in. Do not compare. You're in the dead zone if you compare. We're an artist. We're that's our job, to create something new and be unique. That's an artist's definition. Yeah,
that's true. That's very true. When would you say is a good time? Someone that might, you know, I mean, you're an entrepreneur. You're not just selling your art at galleries. You're not just getting money from your competitions, or money just from the video. Like, when would someone know that they're ready to start teaching other beginners? Or, you know, they've been working, they've been drawing, they've been painting, they've maybe done some competitions. When do you think they might be ready to teach someone that doesn't know anything about watercolor?
Yeah, that's a good question. But being a teacher, it's a calling. So not all artists can teach. So not all. There's so many fabulous artists, but sometimes they're not, you know, capable of teaching. So if you can teach, that will be plus. You know, so to answer your question, yeah, start, you know, having like plan a group and try, you know, share something for free. So and then see if they believe in you. So once everything is believe in you, and then I think you're capable of your teaching. I mean, everybody is different. So but the important is, I mean, teach something like, you know, so helpful, and not like, you know, like follow me all the time. Like, no, you have to do this. No. But again, teaching is an art. So everybody is teach differently. So you can assess yourself that you're capable of teaching if somebody believes in you. But again, I mean, before you can teach, there's a lot of homework to do. There's a lot of homework to do. Yeah, you have to market yourself, because if you offer workshop, of course, if you're a good teacher, I didn't know, no one believes in you, nobody enrolled. So so you have to market yourself, you know. I mean, those marketing skills, I got that from as an architect, because as an architect, our best product, the best marketing is our product. That's our principle. So, I mean, if you have a good product, it's easy to market. I mean, you know, everybody's just call your office. Oh, can we have some projects? And I mean, yeah. So if you transfer the one as an artist, yeah, you have to have a good product before you market yourself. Yeah, because if you market, I mean, spend a lot of money, maybe you have some, you know, feedback or whatever. But if your product is less superior according to your how you market, it's just a vibe. So it won't last long. So marketing and your product is two big things.
That's so good. And I know some students, they're wondering, you know, how do you know when your painting is finished? Some people, you know, you could tell they're new at watercolor because maybe they didn't finish the painting, you know, all the way. You could tell a painting that was done very safely and not pushed enough. And then you can see a painting that's, you know, overcooked. How do you know that a painting is done?
Okay, so for me, I have time frame. So my maximum painting is 3 hours only. So I know after 3 hours, it is overdue. So that's one. So if I paint big, I use bigger brush. So the same number of strokes. So that's one. And also, when I do the shadows and the darks, I mean, technically, that's 90 to 80% done, because you cannot adjust once you, like, you know, oh, I don't like this. And then you overlay or wash those dark shadows, it will burst. That's it. So that's one. Like, if I do the connector, which is the shadows, the big shadows, the darks, That's, I can tell that I'm almost done. And technically, that's a very common question as an artist, how to stop. So how to stop? I sign my works. That's mean, this is mean business. That's it. But just to, like, you know, to say that I'm done, normally when I paint the day before, I cannot, even though I signed that one, I say that one is done. It early in the morning, I drink my coffee. I'm a coffee guy in the morning. And I drink, I watch my painting. And if there's no other inputs or ideas come in, I think I'm done. Yeah, like clean slate. You can say, like, oh, there's something wrong here. Need some light. Oh, that's awkward. The perspective is wrong. No, in the morning, you have clean slate minded. And then after that, that's it. When I say, yeah, that's it. I cannot re-put highlight, that's it. Yeah.
That's so good. I really appreciate you being generous with your time. If there is like one other person I think you could speak into, is maybe that person that stopped painting, but they know they should be painting. Maybe something tragic happened into their life, you know? What would you say to that one individual?
Yeah, I mean, I'm, to be honest, I'm a product of that. I'm a divorcee too. So what makes me man again or grounded again? Of course, with the help from the man above and also the watercolor. I mean, the art itself. I mean, I think if I didn't found love again in watercolor, I'm not here. You know? I'm in the box way, way before. So watercolor helps me, makes me find a purpose in my life, find joy, find some friends like you. I mean, there's, I got a trade. So right now, I'm a divorcee, but I married with watercolor. I think a bow.
That's so good. That's so good. Well, thank you so much. I'm going to put down in the link your video and your website. And how else can people get a hold of you and follow you for the future?
Oh, yes. It's Vios Watercolor. Vios Watercolor .com. Vioswatercolor.com. And you can follow me. This year, I have, like, I'm going to Denver for the plein air PACE 2023 as a faculty. And luckily, I'm so grateful that I'm invited with the four major invitation. So I'm going to Door, Homestead, Laguna, and Forgotten Coast. So I have probably 12 events and four to five workshop along the way. So it's going to be a long, exciting year ahead.
That's wonderful. We're all going to keep cheering you on. You have a lot of amazing people that just appreciate you for who you are. And you have your own voice in the circles of watercolor. And so, and those people that have been watching, thank you so much.
Wow, wasn't that just a super good, like, interview? There is so much packed in there, you guys. He gave you so many nuggets. You're gonna have to watch this over. And the link, I will definitely put the link in the notes and all that stuff. And so, God willing, this video loads while I'm on my trip. And I hope you really enjoy this. If you have any questions or comments, just put them down there. Some of the last videos that we've done with the other artists, you guys have interacted with them. So this is your chance to go ahead and maybe ask a question that I didn't ask. And Richie might answer it for you. All right. Enjoy it. And we'll see you in the next video. Take care.